This is going to be the last lecture for me. Thank you all for sticking around. Ignore the board for now. Okay, so last lecture we saw, I went through a couple modern weak source quantum theory, showed you the principles they assumed, and how do you get to quantum theory. And what I want to do in this lecture is focus on my own research in this area. So I'm going to go through a reconstruction of my own, which is based on principles regarding the well-behavedness of sequential measurement. So I'll say more about that. And then after time allowing, I will talk about how you can generalize probabilistic theories. So that you can even get rid of the assumptions that your probabilities happen to lie in the real unit interval. And that's going to be the part of the talk where I'm allowed to become more difficult and stuff, and I will lose some people. But. Okay, so sequential measurement. So the DS gave me a sort of GPT-like framework. I have a physical black box kind of system in which I can do binary measurements, maybe I notice some state, and I shine a laser into this box or whatever, and out comes a number of 0 or 1, depending on which that gives me a measurement outcome. Okay, measurement of call effects. And the idea is now that I can do measurements in sequence on the same system. Okay, so I can first do a measurement A, and then, I'm going to write this and then, A measurement B. Okay, so first measure A and then B. So it's going to get how this works in quantum theory. So if I have a state rho, and I have an effect E, the probability that I observe the outcome associated to E is given by this trace rule, right? And then the state updates to this new state. Okay, so apply the effect to the square root on both sides and normalize to get the normalized state. If I then try to calculate the probability that I see an effect F on this updated state, I just take the trace rule again, I get this thing, right? So now if I want to know the product probability, what's the probability I see E and then I see F, well, I need to take the product of this thing and this thing. Okay, so I get trace rho E and this thing, and because trace is linear, I can take this thing outside of the expression. And because the trace is circular, I can take this square root of E and put it on the other side. So I get this expression, which simplifies to this thing. Okay? This is trace rho square root E F square root E. The square root E F square root E is again an effect. So I'm gonna say that measuring E and then F, this results in the effect square root E F square root E. Okay? So that's what this AND does to effects in the case of quantum theory. Okay, yeah, so A and B is the probabilities are given when they're both measures. Now, what you can say for a general theory is that, of course, measuring A and then B is not going to give you the same probabilities as measuring B and then A, because it's a black box and you just do some measurement, do something to it, you don't know what happened to the state. So of course the state will in general change. So a priori, you cannot say these things are equal. And this, of course, the thing in what we see is classical theory is that this is equal. You can do measurements without disturbing the system. So the order of measurement doesn't matter. So I'm going to say the two effects A and B are compatible when the order of measurement does not matter. Okay? And I've got some special symbol. I'm just going to write A commute B. Quantum theory, you can show that it's a bit hard that things commute in this way when they actually commute as operators. So these things coincide.
What is this guy?
It requires the Fouquet-Putnam-Rosenblum theorem. Yeah. It's quite a nice proof. I can go through it
after that. Because it seems obvious.
It seems obvious, it's not. Okay, so reconstruction in a nutshell. I'm going to start with a GPT framework. I'm going to outline some requirements for this operation of and then. And we're going to see how much structure we can derive from that, and we will see that it will be entirely quantum theory, almost, because you also need to add one additional assumption, which will be local tomography. Okay, so the GPTs, my system is going to be five-dimensional vector spaces, actually ordered unit spaces. So the effects elements like this. States are just states, like we already discussed. Yeah, I need one more thing. So what I need is the no restriction hypothesis for effects, which you can show it follows from this assumption that if I have two effects, such that the added probabilities of the effect for any state is smaller than one, if that means that A plus B is an effect, which is sort of a statistical effect I can do by preparing like the state many times and like measuring A on one set and B on the other set and like adding probabilities together. If this is like a real effect again, like this gives me sort of the no restriction hypothesis. And it also makes taking all the space. Okay, so now I want to go through the properties that I will require of the sequential products and them. Okay, so let's start with an ensemble of systems, and it's all prepared in like the same state. And we measure A on all of them. Okay? And now we split our ensemble of states into two different sets, and we measure B on one half, we measure C on one half. The probabilities we get from that are described by this expression, right? We do A, and then we measure this statistical measurement of B plus C. Okay? But we can describe the situation in a different manner. We can say we split the group of states into two sets, and we measure A and B on one half, and B and A and C on the other half. And that description gives us this. But these are just two equivalent descriptions of the same thing. So we require that these two expressions should be equal. So it should be additive in the second argument. And you see in quantum theory, of course, it's going to be linear in this argument. So that's it. In general, we do not have additivity in the first argument, because this A plus B is defined in a statistical manner. So there's no way in which we can say, oh, we have measured the system in the A plus B effect. So this is, in general, is not an expression that means anything. Okay? And you also see in quantum theory, like, you have the square root, which destroys the linearity. So. Okay, and then I have another assumption, which says resistance to noise. So I'm just going to say this operation is going to be continuous in the first argument. And the reason for that is that you, if you're approaching an ideal type of measurement, you would hope that your probabilities also like sort of converge to this unique thing, right? So you want sort of continuity property on your effects. Okay. So I said like if A and B commute, if they're compatible, the measurement order is irrelevant. We can sort of see again that we can sort of measure them at the same time. And the way we're going to capture that property is that we say if A and B commute, then this kind of associativity holds. So this is like kind of like measuring A and then B and then C, the same sort of measuring A and B at the same time and then measuring C. I would actually say that like this property to me should make sense for all A, B, and C, regardless of if they commute, because it sort of seems like sort of a natural property of like and then. But like you can sort of like see in quantum theory it's not true. So it's sort of this reposition where I think the natural axiom is not something that satisfies the quantum theory. So if we're imagining someone who like tries to discover like from classical theory a new sort of more general theory, I think you would first like accept this axiom for all A, B, and C and then realize you only get classical theory and then maybe you weaken this too, like this property. Mm. Anyway. We have the effect one, which just always returns true. So we can sort of implement a system in a trivial manner by not even touching the system. Mm-hmm. So of course, like first measuring this thing is not going to affect like the second measurement outcome. Okay, we denote A perp as sort of the measure A and invert the outcome. So like it's this measurement is successful if it's if the original one is not successful, and just flip the outcomes of what we decide to be the right outcome. This is just a classical kind of post-processing step. So of course, if A and B are compatible, A not A is also going to be compatible with B. Okay. Similarly, we require that if A and B are compatible and A and C are compatible, A is going to be compatible with B plus C, and A is going to be compatible with B and then C. Because these are again like the sort of classical things we can do outside of the black box. So we have classical control over it. I think this is the final property. Suppose A and then B is zero. So this means we never have a situation where we first observe A and then we observe B. This never happens. What I'm going to say then is that this should imply that first measuring B and then A is also zero. I can't really argue this from like an operational point of view. It's just a nice property that like you could assume on theory. And it's true in quantum theory. So it's true in classical theory, so maybe like a person who tries to discover quantum theory would just accept this because it seems so natural, but there's no like super solid justification for this. Okay, so the summary. I'm going to define a sequential effect space as to be an order unit space, where I have an operation on the effects, which satisfies all these actions I just outlined. Okay. This is not a random collection of properties. I did not come up with this. These first four were defined to be a sequential effect algebra by Gunnar and Gucci. I only added this last condition of continuity. Okay, so like for me, it's already points was more naturality because like they had these assumptions because they just wanted to do interesting stuff with them and not to reconstruct quantum theory. Okay, so for me, that's already a sign. This is like a quite natural set of properties.
This continues, you mean in sort of a weak sense? So we evaluate on
finite dimensional small topologies or operations. Right. Yeah. Continuous and operating norm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Also, I want to say these properties, if you sort of look at like if you take V to be the solving operator in a complex Hilbert space, and you take an operation of this thing, it is not enough to characterize this operation. There are multiple operations satisfying these axioms. So that's not a sign, this is not too strong. Like I'm not even fully capturing all the things in quantum here.
Mm-hmm.
Like all the operations is you can put a unitary in between like around F here that commutes with E. That's basically the idea which you can do here. Okay. So I'm claiming I can reconstruct quantum theory from these properties. I'm saying that any finite dimensional special effect space is either order isomorphic to a Euclidean Jordan algebra. And the way I'm going to prove that is by using the Cooper-Wimberg theorem, which I outlined in the first lecture, which says that if I have an ordinary space that is both homogeneous and self-dual, it must be a Euclidean Jordan algebra. Mm-hmm. I also want to say any Euclidean Jordan algebra is also a special effect space. So this is sort of a new characterization of Euclidean Jordan algebras. Okay. Right, so I'm just going to briefly go through this proof. The thing, especially the part about proving homogeneity, is actually quite quite straightforward. So first what we show is that if you have a positive real number lambda, this lambda can sort of pull through the product on all sides. So it's like sort of gets this sort of linearity in the homogeneity there. The homogeneity in the order sense. Then you can also show that if A and B are compatible, they can also scale A and remain compatible. What we can then show, because remember I assumed that like if things are compatible, like compatibility is preserved by addition, it's preserved by addition, it's preserved by multiplication, and it's associative in this manner. So we can take the polynomials in a single element A, and then this thing will form a bilinear associative unital positively preserving algebra. And if you again recall from the second lecture, there is a theorem from Catterson that says if you have all the unit space with these properties, then this all the unit space must be isomorphic to the continuous function on the compact Hausdorff space. In a finite dimension, those are all just Rn. So we now know that these polynomials are as an algebra and as an order vector space isomorphic to just Rn. And that means we can write every A as a linear combination of these elements Pi, which are like the basis vectors in Rn, which are idempotent and orthogonal in this sense. Okay. So this is like a spectral theorem for my effects that I get from here. Using the spectral theorem, you can show that elements have pseudo inverses. So if I just take lambda I and then take the minus inverse, if I do this, I go outside of the effects because I get positive elements that are bigger than effects. But like I can, because I have this property and I have this property, I can extend my operation to like all the positive elements of the unit space. So that's not a problem. And we can easily show that this gives us this thing is equal to the ceiling of A, which is the smallest sharp effect above A. In particular, if these ceilings are 1, then this is a proper inverse. And then we can define this map, which is then an order isomorphism, and maps A to B. Okay. And it turns out that the elements which have like ceiling 1 are precisely the internal elements of the positive cone. So this is precisely the property of being homogeneous. Okay. So now we have homogeneity. Okay. Self-duality is going to be a bit more vague, because it's harder to prove. The first step is showing that the sharp effects, so these effects P that I have here with these properties, they form an atomic lattice. Then there is this very awesome work by Olson and Schultz, which have like written a magnum opus about complex spaces and when they are isomorphic to state spaces of operator algebras. And like you can get the results and show this lattice has the covering property. And that follows from the fact that you can show that this operation, if P is atomic and I do an A, I put an A before it, this remains atomic. So it's sort of like preservation and atomicity. And this is because we have the covering property, every sharp effect will have a unique dimensionality associated to it. This allows us to, again, as in the previous reconstructions I showed, allows us to reduce the problem to like a smaller system, namely a system spanned by two atomic effects. And it turns out that the order unit space we get then is something that has a strictly convex code. I'm not going to define what that means. But the important part of that is that a paper in 2017, they show that any finite dimensional order unit space, which is homogeneous and strictly convex, is order isomorphic to a spin factor, like is a Dukey-Jordan algebra. In particular, such a space is self-dual. Now it turns out we can lift the self-duality on the subspaces to self-duality in the whole space. Okay? So that means we have self-duality, we already had homogeneity, so now we know that the Hooke Grimberg, it's a Euclidean-Jordan algebra. So we're already like super close to quantum theory. Okay? Now the question is, how do we get from Euclidean-Jordan algebra to quantum theory? Well, we already saw the answer in like many previous reconstructions. Namely, we look at composite systems and we require local tomography. Okay? Two things specifically, if I have two special effect spaces, I just require that their composite has like, this dimension property, that it dimensionally multiplies. And I have this sort of very natural property about sequential measurement of independent effects, right? Because this means like I have an independent effect on each of subsystems, independent effect on each subsystem. If I do them sequentially, it's the same as doing sequentially in each of the separate systems. And then you can show that if I have a finite dimensional sequential effect space V, which allows a locally tomographic composite, so like a normal special effect space with these properties, then V must have been a complex C-star algebra. And for me, that's quantum theory. So then we have quantum theory. A locally tomographic general probability theory, special effect spaces embeds into the category C-star algebras of completely positive maps. So this is the full theorem, if you want to put all the conditions in there. I just want to say a few things about this. Finite dimensional. What I think is interesting about these axioms, if you want to call them axioms, is that they are also true of infinite dimensional quantum theory, and they're actually true of infinite dimensional Jordan algebras, which is not something that can be said about all the other reconstructions I showed. They all have assumptions that are only true in finite dimension. Like the uniqueness of purification stuff, like you need to really modify this thing to make it work in infinite dimension. And like local tomography loses its power and like infinite dimension, but yeah. So these properties like are still all true in infinite dimension. Being all unit space is necessary. If it's just an order vector space, I have counterexamples. Like you can show that you have things satisfying these properties that are not like a Jordan algebra or C-star algebra. This property, which I sort of identify as the weakest property among all of these, like the least motivated property, is actually not needed for the proof of homogeneity. So you still get homogeneity without this property. And so if you have a system of informational dimension 2, then you can still use this classification theorem that you still get self-dual space. So for a bit-like system, the proof still holds if I remove this axiom. But like I don't know whether it's necessary to prove self-duality. Like, I'm unclear on that. Then this property, which is if A commutes with B and C, then A commutes with B and then C, is actually not needed for this proof. I only included it because it's part of the definition of the sequential effect algebra. It is necessary to prove additional stuff in the infinite dimensional case, but you can do some interesting stuff there as well. Let's see. Okay, so conclusion. Finite dimensional unit space plus a continuous sequential product gives you a Euclidean algebra. Adding local tomography gets you a C-star algebra. Therefore, sequential measurement characterizes quantum theory. Okay. Is there any questions about this stuff?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was wondering in the first part of the first axiom, like distributivity, can you say why it's necessary again?
Because which one?
The first axiom, this one, yeah. Because from what I recall, in like, for example, in quantum logic, it's precisely a property that is abandoned. Why do you need it here in this reconstruction? Like, is it?
I mean, it's not abandoned in quantum logic because this sum in quantum logic, when you have a sharp effect, is only defined.
Okay.
I wasn't clear on that. Mm. We're working with effects, right?
Okay.
So this sum is not always defined. So we only define this property when the sum is defined.
Okay, okay.
And in sharp cases, this is only defined when the two things are orthogonal, and then it's true in quantum logic.
Yeah,
sorry, okay. This is a good question. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Even the question, which is more motivational, it seems that you are giving big importance to the idea of sequence,
mm-hmm.
that we are doing one thing after another.
Mm-hmm.
Then this seems to imply that you have in the background a given time and a given arrow of time.
Mm-hmm.
If such is the case, then I would not expect the reconstruction to be really fundamental, because I would rather expect the arrow of time to emerge from quantum theory rather than being given a
prime. Yeah. So this is all operational, right? Like I said, I'm in a lab, I have this box, and like I'm doing experiments and writing down results. So like, of course, like, because I'm a causal being, like it already presupposes that I'm in this universe where I'm like observing these like statistics and stuff.
Mm.
So yeah, there's sort of like an operational derivative quantity. Like it's not fundamental in the sense that you can start with an empty space-time or whatever and like do something there.
So I think the
thing we're trying to reconstruct is the standard like non-relativistic quantum theory. But I think it will be very interesting to see if this kind of sequential condition can be generalized to
space-time
picture.
Yeah, I have no idea. Maybe you already motivated it a little bit. Why do you start from vector spaces? Why to a system you associate a vector space? For me, already this is quite restrictive because
so
you said you wanted to motivate wide Hilbert spaces. Why linearity?
I explained this in the second lecture when I went from GPT. So if you accept that your state space and effect space must be convex sets, which I'm not sure do you accept that?
Yeah, maybe.
Like a convex set can always be like formally embedded in an ordered vector space. So that's just a mathematical property. You can always describe a if you have this duality between these convex sets, like because like every state and every effect, I associate a probability to it. This allows you to make an ordered vector space. So that follows from it. Like it's not an assumption. It follows from the fact that you have convex sets and this relation between states and effects. Yeah, it's subtle. It's subtle. It's okay. If there's no more questions about this, I'm gonna go to my next topic. Let's see how much. So I just want to compare this reconstruction of my own to like some of the other ones. So. What I like is that it's very economical in the concepts it needs, right? Like, the concept you need is a sequential product. And like, okay, you need states and effects, and you need to have like, you have to have probabilities and stuff. But other than that, like, it's very economical. Well, if you look at these other reconstructions I talked about, you need to have the concept of pure states and pure effects, you need to have the concept of perfect distinguishability, or maybe like of purification, like there's lots of additional stuff you have to add. It doesn't use any pure transitivity axiom, which I like because I don't find it very well motivated why you would need such an axiom, like why you would require such a thing for your theory. And also I find it interesting from a mathematical point of view that it's possible to reconstruct without using it. And also I don't have any filter axiom. The fact that you can go down to a small system and reconstruct from there is something that follows from these things I have here. And I like that local tomography is only used at the very end. Like you can join algebras without using it at all, and then at the end is sort of like an additional thing. Like I don't even have to use local tomography if some new property comes along that allows you to select complex feature algebras from all from Jordan algebras, you can replace local tomography with that thing and it still works. And I like the fact that these axioms are not specific to finite dimensional systems. Like I haven't made any assumption that's not true in infinite dimensional quantum systems, because you can argue if you make an assumption that's only true in finite dimension, it's not a very natural property, because like a lot of physicists do quantum mechanics in infinite dimension, right? Okay.
I have another question. Before you've not been talking about the reconstruction of a Philippe Hearn. Are you aware of it?
I tried reading it, but it was very long and I didn't understand it.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm aware of it, like. Yeah, this thing with like information acquisition kind of principles or something.
Yeah. It's also in terms of information, and I think it's quite minimal. I don't know the details of it, but you talked about it.
Yeah. I sort of browsed through the paper and I tried to find all the assumptions he makes, and he does make a lot of assumptions. And like,
yeah,
from even just a casual reading, I couldn't understand them.
Okay.
But, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So what I want to talk about now is generalizing generalized political theories. And the way I'm going to generalize them is by replacing the real numbers. Because this is going to get a lot more abstract. And I might lose some of you, and if you want to leave, that's fine. Okay, so first, a little primer of category theory. Who really knows what a category is? Okay, about half. Alright, so very briefly, a category consists of objects and morphisms between these objects. So you can think of these as sets and functions between sets. And we require these morphisms to compose in an associative manner. And for each object A, we have an identity. That's a very minimal definition of what a category is. And then, like, interesting things with categories, you have functors, which are the maps between categories. And what a functor does, it associates to every object A in the original category, a new object in the target category. And it also does the same for a morphism. If you have a morphism in the first category, it becomes a morphism in the second category, and like with the objects here. And then it has a property, namely it preserves composition. So the composition of two maps must, I can pull out sort of this thing here, and it preserves identities. Okay. And the useful notion is a functor is faithful when it's injective morphism, so it sends two different morphisms to two different morphisms. And because that allows us to say that this category is a subcategory of another one, like if there's a faithful embedding, like maybe full of faithful is better. Right, so the point is, a GPT we can see as a category. And then like the systems are your objects. We identify a special system, a special object, that I call an empty system or trivial system. And I'm going to denote by letter I. Okay. And the operations are just morphisms in the category. Now, a GPT has special properties, namely what we call HOM sets. So the set of all morphisms between two given objects is a convex set. In the language of category theory, we would say that GPTs are enriched over convex sets. Okay. And another property is that scalars, so scalars are the morphisms from the trivial object to the trivial object, they correspond to the real unit interval. Okay, so every morphism is actually a real number. And then...
How do you say that it's a convex set?
How do I say it's a convex set?
Yeah, how can you see it from the...
It's just the thing you put in. I didn't really talk about it because I focused on states and effects, but
yeah.
We actually also assume that we can take probabilistic combinations of and then we identify the states as the morphisms that go from the empty system to a system. And the way to think about it is because like a state preparation is you don't start with a state and you end up with a state, right? So a state is kind of like preparing something from nothing. And the same way, an effect is a measurement, is a way to destroy the system, so to remove the system from consideration. So it's kind of the intuition why we have identified states and effects with these particular whole sets. And then if you take a composition of first a state, and then a effect, so you go from the trivial object to A, and from A to the trivial object, so we get a morphism from I to I, those correspond to real numbers, so this becomes the probability that P holds some states over there. Okay? So this is kind of a rephrasing of GPTs in terms of category theory. Okay, now I'm going to generalize GPTs to something called an effectus. Because the problems with GPTs are that they can't really describe deterministic models, because we put probabilities in from the start. Like I always say, like, I'm a classical observer that can do classical things to my system, so I always get convex combinations of states, effects, transformations, and I get probabilities out of it. And the second one is a bit more like abstract, I guess, but the assumptions on classical probability are baked in. So that the fact that I represent the probability by a real number, like, is a very basic fact, but you can still question it. Like, if you're talking about, like, generating a physical theory from first principles, you're like, why would it even have probabilities modeled by the real numbers? Okay, so I'm going to try to, combat these problems.
But sorry, but if you want to have a meaningful notion of probability, I can't think of something which would not be real. number.
Yeah, that's actually going to be the conclusion of my thesis. Like, if you have enough like nice properties, you get real numbers for free. So that's going to be what I'll be working towards.
But to me, it's not a problem. It's just natural. To
yeah, this. I mean, sure.
I want this to be physical theory, so to have meaning on it. And
yeah, no, it's yeah.
If reals are natural for you.
Sorry?
If reals are natural for you, which is not the case for a lot of people.
No, but it's not so much about reals. It could be Q numbers between 0 and 1 and still have probability. It's not so much about.
Yeah, I mean, you can also I like to think from like a sort of also this mathematical point of view. It's like, can we do without? Like, it's sort of a question like out of large kind of interest, you know? If you're fine with real numbers, that's great. But you can still I can still question it. I can still be like, nah, I didn't think so. It's not going to be. Okay, so. If we were going to replace this very natural notion of real numbers, like what should we even replace it with? R is a commutative monoid. It has plus with the addition operation. The same holds if you just restrict to the positive numbers. But the question is, this is not true for just a real unit of all, which arguably actually probabilities and not the real numbers. So what is the structure that the real unit of all has? Something we call a partial commutative monoid. So the idea is that I have an addition operation, we're going to write this funky symbol, but this addition is not always defined. So I'm going to write this symbol, so x is perpendicular to y, x is orthogonal to y, so let's say, when this sum is defined. And I have these equations, but these equations should be read as, if the left-hand side is defined, then the right-hand side should be defined. Okay, and the same for these other equations. Okay. So examples. The real unit interval is a motivating example, so this is indeed a partial commutative monoid. A different example is I can think of a partial function, so which only sometimes associates an element. Sometimes fx is y, but fx can also be undefined. Okay, and you can organize partial functions into a category of partial functions. Composition is kind of like, if you think about it for a bit, there's a natural notion of composition. It turns out that the whole sets, so the set of partial functions between two given sets, is a PCM. How is it a PCM? Well, we say f and g are summable when the domains of definition are disjoint. So if they're only defined on like sort of separate subsets, and then we define their sum as the union of f and g. Okay. So this is a very different type of PCM than the real unit interval. Another example would be if you take the category of unital C-star algebras, then I can look at the whole sets between two given C-star algebras. And I say that the morphisms are positive subunital maps. Subunital means they map one below one. And I say two things are summable when like the sum of their ones is still below one, and then I just define the sum in the regular way. Okay?
Can you just remember me what the PCM stands for?
Partial commutative monoid. Okay. It turns out actually that these kind of properties say that partial functions and C-star algebras are examples of PCM enriched categories. But what that means is that the sum operation it sort of distributes over composition. So the composition in the category is compatible with the sum structure. Okay. This is the same type of property like if we see GPTs as being enriched over convex sets, we require that composition of things respects this convex structure, so it respects like a convex combination of things. In sort of an abstract version of saying that. Okay. Well, it turns out that 0,1 is not just a PCM, because the 1 has a special role in this thing. What is this special role? Well, for every element A, there is a unique complement, so that they sum up to 1. Okay. And if A is summable with 1, A must have been 0. And if you have PCM with these two extra properties, we call it an effect algebra. Okay. Effect algebra actually is a long lineage of generalizing definitions. In quantum logic, they started with orthomodular lattices, and they was like, no, this is not general enough. We need to generalize it to an ortho lattice. And they was like, no, it's not general enough. We need to generalize it to an ortho algebra. And it's not general enough. And then you got effect algebra. So it's sort of like generalizing, then not generalizing. So the examples 0,1, of course. Where the complement is just 1 minus a, okay, any Boolean algebra, and I define, I say that A and B are summable when like their join is zero, and then I define the sum as their meet. And A purpose is random negation. Okay. And this is the motivating example for an effect algebra. If I look at the morphisms in the category of positive supplemental maps from C to Zeta algebra A, this corresponds to the unit interval of the Zeta algebra. And then this is an effect algebra with just also 1 minus A as a complement. Okay. Is this somewhat clear? Okay, so now we can define what an effect is. So an effect is a PCM enriched category with a designated object I, so a trivial object, an empty object, such that, well, CS copolis and copolis are compatible with PCM structure. This doesn't matter for my talk, it's just part of the definition, but I won't need it, so I'm not going to say much about it. Just that the copolis you can see as a classical disjunction of systems. If I have a system A, I have a system B, well, I can say, well, I can prepare a state here or a state there. And then the way you model the system is by the coproduct. That's kind of the reasoning behind it. More important property is that I say that the morphisms from A to I, they must form an effect algebra. Which means in particular we have a special element 1A and special element 0A, which correspond to the 1 and 0 in this effect algebra. Okay. And there's two other properties which sort of relate this 1s and 0s to the rest of the category. So that if a morphism is sends 1 to 0, then the entire morphism must have been 0. And if f and g are orthogonal or like summable on 1, then they are just summable morphisms. And examples where you see partial functions, they form a effectus where the trivial object is just the one element set. And then it turns out that the effects, so the morphisms from object A to the one element set, they correspond to the power set of A. So they are all the subsets. Mm-hmm. Okay, and in Zeta algebra we need to take the opposite category, so now we take all the arrows going the opposite direction. And that means that still the morphisms from A to I are actually just the effect algebra of the effects in the Zeta algebra. Okay.
Excuse me?
Yes.
This definition you give on a fixtures, is it completely equivalent to the one using only limits?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, if you take that definition and then you look at the category of partial maps, that's this thing. And if this thing is a notion of total map, and then that is the equivalent of that thing. So that's actually it's a two categorical equivalence. So, yeah. Okay. Okay. So I'm going to relate the factors to GPTs a bit more. So if I have an effectus, this effect forms an effect algebra by definition. Turns out that the states, so the morphisms from I to A, they form something called an abstract convex set. I'm not going to find what that is, but like, yeah, it's an abstract version of convex set. And again, like given a state and effect, I can compose them and I get a scalar. So this is kind of like how the structure of a GPT sort of translates to an effect. And in a sense, every GPT is an effectus. In a sense. So in GPT, these scalars are just the real numbers. So what are they in an arbitrary effectus? Okay. Well, in these examples we have of partial functions, these scalars here are just the booleans. Okay, this is kind of like a deterministic effectus. Yeah. Well, in Zeta algebra, the scalars are the real unit interval. A Zeta algebra they form a GPT. Okay, but in general, what can we say? Well, we know by definition of effectus, this thing is an effect algebra. Okay, but also it has a multiplication. This multiplication is given by composition. I can just go from I to I to a scalar S, and then I can go T, so I get a composition. And this makes a multiplication operation on my scalars. Okay? So we can give a name to this multiplication operation. So I'm going to say an effect monoid is an effect algebra which has an associative distributed multiplication. So that means that these operations hold. Okay? Examples again. The real unit interval, which is a regular multiplication, is an effect monoid. Any Boolean algebra, remember we defined the sum to be just the join. You can take the product just to be the mean. Okay? This is any Boolean algebra is an effect monoid. If I have a space of functions from a compact Hausdorff space to the real unit interval, this is a effect monoid with just pointwise operations. So pointwise addition, pointwise multiplication, pointwise inverse, pointwise evolution. And this is actually the unit interval of the commutative unit of Zeta algebra, so in this sense, effect monoids correspond, these correspond to the unitfall of the commutative C-Sarsbus. The unitfall of regular C-Sarsbus is not an example, because we need this multiplication operation, and you would think, okay, I can just take the multiplication of two elements of C-Sarsbus, but it doesn't preserve positivity, so it doesn't end up in the unitfall again, so you need commutativity for this work. Okay. So it turns out that the structure of your scalars and an effectus that like defines a lot of the structure of your effectus. Okay? So if I have some effectus and I have my set of scalars, which is going to be denoted by M for effect monoid, it turns out that the effects have an action of the scalars via just multiplying some composition. So in a GPT, this would be if I multiply my effect by sort of a real number to scale it down. Right? And we can axiomatize the structure, and we get something, an M effect module. And we can organize these things into a category of effect modules, and it turns out that this forms an effectus for any arbitrary effect monoid. And we always have a functor that goes from an effectus to the category of effect modules over the appropriate effect monoids. Dually, we can do the same thing with states instead of effects. So we can associate a weight to every state, which is just the value it has on 1. So if you think about normalized states, they send 1 to 1, so they have a weight of 1. But you can also have like sub-normalized states. So if I forgot about this normalization here, like this thing would not map, would not be a normalized state that thing we get out. Okay. And again, we can axiomatize this in a proper manner. And we get a category of weight modules over a given effect monoid. And again, we have a functor from the effectus, so the state functor, to these weight modules. Okay. The takeaway from this is that there's two ways to organize, to take any effect monoid and to construct an effectus from it. So, because there are quite weird effect monoids, it's a very general structure, there are quite weird effectuses. So if you view an effectus as sort of a very abstract model of a GPT, of like a thing you could do in a lab, then it turns out there are very like pathological kind of things you can do. Okay. So far, any questions? Like I realize this is a bit harder and more abstract than other stuff I'm doing, but any questions so far? Okay. So because this is the question gets quite pathological, I want to add some more things and make it less pathological. Okay. The way I'm going to do that is by realizing that the real numbers do not just have finite sums, they have countable sums, or at least some of them. Okay. And if you restrict to the real unit interval, then such a countable sum exists even only if all the finite subsystems, all the finite sums exist. Right? Okay, so we can then define a sigma PCM, partial commutative monoid, to be a partial commutative monoid where a countable sum exists if all the finite subsums exist. So you need to formalize this in a proper way, but you can do it. Okay, so examples of this. Well, the category of partial functions actually turns out that the homesteads here, they are sigma PCMs. If I replace my category of C star algebras by W star algebras, so phenomenal algebras, with normal positive subcommutative maps, then it turns out that the homesteads are sigma PCMs. And in fact, you can show that these two categories are sigma PCM enriched, which I'm not going to define what that means, but it's the version of sigma PCMs that you have the PCMs. And then we can give a definition of sigma effectus, which is we have an effectus, but instead of just being PCM enriched, we say it's sigma PCM enriched, and instead of just having finite coproducts, we say it's countable coproducts. Okay? And examples are the category of partial functions and the category of Vernoyan algebras in the opposite direction. And it turns out that these things are really quite well behaved and nice. So the reason for that. If I look at the effect algebra for a given object in the sigma effectus, this turns out to be omega complete, which means that if I have an increasing sequence of effects, it has a supremum. And now there's a theorem that I proved together with the Poisson-Braun-Westerbaum twins last year, which I think is a really cool result, although it takes a while to appreciate why it's cool. But if I have an effect monoid that is omega directed complete, so it has this property, then this M embeds into a direct sum of M1 and M2, where M1 is a omega complete Boolean algebra, And M2 is the space of functions from a compact Hausdorff space into the unit interval for basically this mechanism. So this, so why is this cool? Well, a couple of reasons. An effect model is a really abstract structure and a lot of like pathological ones. But now it embeds into a very canonical thing. It's like M1 is a Boolean algebra. I'm like, what has been more studied than a Boolean algebra? And then M2 is a commutative C-square algebra. And what has been studied more than commutative C-square algebras? So we take this abstract structure and we get these very two very canonical things out of it. Okay.
What is basically this connectedness?
I can say there's an equivalence, a commutative C-square algebra. The compact Hausdorff space is basically disconnected if and only if the C-square algebra is omega directed complete.
What?
Is omega directed complete.
Okay.
Topologically, it means that co-zero, the closure of a co-zero set is open.
Okay.
Is the, yeah.
Okay. Is it
yeah.
weaker or?
It's weaker than extremely desperate.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it doesn't have to be a Dijkstra.
No. Okay.
Is this embedding unique or
no, it's not unique. No.
Okay, but because sometimes you have something completely difficult, you can embed it in something easy. But this does not mean that the complicated stuff becomes easier. So.
It's true, not necessarily, but we can derive a lot of useful things from this.
Okay.
So a useful thing is that the scalars must be commutative. Because like I didn't define a effect model to be commutative. But because it embeds into these two things that are commutative, it must be commutative to start with. So it's a really non-trivial result that like you wouldn't be able to see easily from first principles, I think. Another result you can prove in this is you get this large equivalence. So if I have a sigma effectus, where I find the scalars M to be this thing, and the following are all equivalent, okay? And this uses this characterization theorem. So states in effectus can be normalized. So what I mean by that is if I have a subnormalized state, then I can find a state that's normalized that sort of reduces to it if I scale it down again. Okay, which is sort of the thing we assume implicitly in an GPT. There's not you don't get it for free in effectus. You need to actually require it. This is just some categorical thing. M is a division operation. So if you think about Bayesian statistics, if you want to do a Bayesian update, you always need to divide your probability at some point. So you need a division operation. And it turns out, so you can require if you have a division operation. M has no zero divisors, just an algebraic condition, or M is irreducible, so I can't write my scalars as a direct sum of order scalars. So all these things are equivalent. And if any of these things hold, then my scalars must have been one of these three. So my scalars must have been like absolutely trivial, like nothing happens. My scalars must have been Booleans, or my scalars must have been a real unit interval. Okay. Now, why is that cool? Well, so if I take my sigma effectus with normalization, so normalization is one of the conditions I sort of state here in these equivalents, they come in three types. Either my scalar is just zero. And when this is the case, you can show your category is equivalent to the trivial single object category with a single morphism. So it's absolutely trivial, nothing happens. So we don't care about this. Other possibility, the scalars are my Booleans. That means that the category is deterministic. The probability that the effect holds on the state is either 0 or 1. So it either holds with perfect probability or doesn't hold at all. Or the scalars are probabilistic. And in that case, we basically have a GPT. And I'm going to make it more formal later. So the probabilities are an actual real probability. What we need to do now is to make like these statements sort of more clear and more meaningful, we need to have separation properties. And that's, if you recall back from the second lecture, I defined this like operational equivalence principle for GPTs. So like if a state acts the same, if two states act the same in all possible measurements, they must have been the same state, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no way to distinguish them, but we can also define that for an effectus. So I'm going to say an effectus has state separation. When two morphisms that are equal in all possible states, then the morphism must have been equal. And equivalently, we can say this functor from the category to the appropriate weight motion category must be faithful. Similarly, we can also define effect separation. Well, it turns out our two main examples, they all have state and effect separation. But the interesting non-example is I can take the category of effect algebras, which is equivalent to the category of effect modules over the Booleans. Then I can look at the set of the projections on a Hilbert space, and this is an effect algebra. And if the dimension of H is greater than 2, then the Cochran Speckle theorem says that the state space is completely empty. Okay? So effect algebras is a category that does not have state separation. So this sort of says like, because like, yeah, we know quantum theory is not deterministic, so we shouldn't have these states into the Booleans, right?
Yeah.
So like requiring state separation is sort of a natural property, but also get these really weird things, like these quantum systems are living in this sort of like classical world.
John?
Yeah?
Can you try to conclude in 2 minutes?
2 minutes. Yeah, I'm almost there. Yeah. Okay. So, look, if I have sigma factors, the scalars are Booleans, and I have state separation, then it turns out they actually embed into the category of partial functions. Or I can make them embed into the Boolean algebra. So, the point of this is that if my scalars are 0, 1 and have state separation, these vectors are entirely classical, because I get this classical structure of Boolean algebras, I get this classical thing of partial functions. The corollary of this is that the non-classical omega factors with normalization must have scalars 0, 1. Okay, so we need to have these probabilities to do something non-classical. Okay, so a simple sort of embedding result holds in probabilistic setting where the scale is 0, 1. So normal unit space, which is complete in its norm, we call a bound for unit space. A sigma unit space, one has counter left sprema. You can make a category of these things, we call sigma bounds. And if they have sigma factors where the scalars are probabilistic and there's effect separation, there's a faithful morphism of sigma factors into this category of unit spaces. And we use our unit space as a model for GPTs, so we basically get the GPT framework from the vectors in this way. Okay?
What do you need the bound condition?
It's just to make the statement more clear. And also, if you don't... actually, Banach follows from sigma.
Mm-hmm.
And you need the sigma to make this in a sigma factor, so this is actually morphism of sigma factors. That's basically what we need. Okay, so a summary of this. A non-trivial sigma factor normalization is either deterministic or it is probabilistic. When it's deterministic, it must be classical and embed in Boolean algebras, partial functions. When it's probabilistic, it must embed into our unit spaces and hence a sort of a GPT-like thing. So we managed to go from like a really abstract categorical framework into a more concrete, well-studied plan of GPTs. Yeah, there's a further work you can do on this stuff to sort of maybe make a reconstruction of quantum theory that doesn't even presuppose the structure of real numbers, which I think is a really interesting thing to do, which is a chapter in my thesis, actually. And yeah. Thank you for listening to this lecture, thank you for listening to all previous lectures, thank you for paying attention, thank you for asking interesting questions, and thank you.